Good afternoon, India. My name is Hans van den Hurk, an intentional text professor from Maastricht University in the Netherlands, and the intentional text indicator in the Netherlands and also around the globe. I was asked to give my first responses on the G7 agreement of this weekend. Apparently, the G7 members seem to be very enthusiastic about the historical agreement which would change the tax world. And I tend to be a little bit less positive than they are. And these are my first responses because there's a long way to go and it doesn't really seem to be interesting to already dive in all the details. But I can give you a few comments already. First of all, a global minimum tax should prevent the world to go into a tax race to the bottom. The lower the tax rate, and therefore is no tax revenue anymore in any states. That rat race to the bottom has not really taken place, at least as far as I know, in the Western world, because every state which decreased the tax rate expanded the tax base, and they also an increase in tax revenues. So it's not really a tax race to the bottom. But more importantly, in my practice, I work for multinationals, and now and then also work for countries, developing countries mostly. The main issue is that developing countries need tax competition as an instrument to survive. African states, if they cannot present a tax holiday to an investor, that investor goes to another state, which incurs for him less risk, because investing in a developing country is a lot of risk, and risk can only be compensated by funds, and funds can be generated by having a lower tax rate, for example. So in the many calls I had in the beginning of this week with clients, I heard that many states are worried about this outcome, because the German Minister of Finance says something, this is an achievement for solidarity. And I thought, what do you mean with solidarity? If a developing country needs to create labor place, they needs to create foreign direct investment, and it lowers its tax rate, then the difference, the delta, goes to the US in principle, and therefore they are not going to attract any new investments with it, and therefore they have very much difficulties to survive as a country. Is that solidarity? I don't think so. Solidarity is only between the Western states which concluded this disagreement. That's my first comment. My second comment is the system which has been created by the same G7 with respect to Pillar 1. And Pillar 1 is a difficult one because it's about the digital economy. And apparently they came to the conclusion that from digital companies that make a global margin of more than 10%, 20% of the difference could be taxable in the marketplace. But if you know that the margin of Amazon.com worldwide is 6.9%, then you will clearly notice that Amazon is not in the scope of the new Pillar 1. And that seemed to be quite strange. I assume a comparable thing will happen with Alibaba, for example. So the Pillar 1 alternative is an OECD alternative. And actually, by saying the marketplace gets a fixed 20% above the delta of 10% rentability of the corporation, lowers the possibility for the marketplaces, for the source states, to my opinion, too much. So what do you see in the agreement? The US wins with the global minimum tax, and Biden needs it in order to get its own tax reform done in the US. And to compensate that, he gives an alternative for pillar one, which, to my opinion, is not reasonable for many states. I have already published in the Netherlands something which relates to an alternative which was developed within the United Nations tax agreement, Article 12b. And Article 12b more or less says something like, if you have a specific revenue in a state, and that revenue can differ from state to state, you can scope that, you can make different position there. If you have a situation where that revenue exceeds the level in a tax treaty, a tax convention, then the source state is allowed to levy a percentage multiplied with the revenue in that state, and the percentage is actually net profit margin globally, and tax it in that state. And that seemed to be much more an easy way forward. And I know there is a lot of criticism within UN about the UN proposal. They were surprised about this because Article 12A, technical services, was not really a success. But the point here is that Article 12B, to my opinion, gives a more principled reallocation of profit between two states. And for me, pillar one solution, as the inclusive framework once defined, can only be started if there is a mandatory dispute resolution foreseen, so that there cannot be any double taxation. So pillar one is not going to give that, because a lot of states have said you're not going to do that. And the solution now from the G7 alternative is not really going to work, because the point with that solution is that it's not, it seems to be easy with 20% above, et cetera, et cetera. But the system is too complex for many countries in the world which do not have a tax administration which is sophisticated enough to actually determine what they can tax. And that, this is not my personal perception, but I work for a group of Latin American countries. I had a call with them yesterday and I heard the same thing. They're not going to be able to do that. So 12B seems to be the simplest solution, by just saying at a certain moment, we want 12B to be inserted. India can say to the Netherlands, we want 12B in the treaty. And the Netherlands can say, fine, we agree, but then we also agree on a mandatory dispute resolution. So a MED procedure should then be mandatory, and which means that there will always be a solution, that there won't be any double taxation. If necessary, arbitration possibly, and I know that India doesn't like it, but you want something, you have to give back something. And the only thing what you give back is taxpayer rights. And they also have their rights, like the states have their rights. So if you look at the G7 perspective, from a European Union point of view, Germany and France love the global minimum tax. For me, it's always a strange thing, because from the global minimum tax perspective, it sounds so logical. If the whole world would just levy 15%, then it's fine. Then we don't have tax competition anymore. But how can you challenge tax competition? Because tax competition is one of the many elements of competition. And why don't you value competition as such? I know it's technically impossible. But by only looking at tax competition, the states which cannot compete because they are smaller, I'm from the Netherlands, but you could also look at states of Belgium, Ireland, Luxembourg. Economies of scale is an issue there. The Netherlands, neighboring country, is Germany. In Germany, grounds, your shopping, cars, whatever you want to buy, houses, everything is much cheaper in Germany than in the Netherlands. So if we want to attract business from a Western point of view, we need to be able to compete on taxes. And But and Germany and France don't like that. They want us to have the same system as they have. But then we have the same tax system with higher costs and all the other elements. And therefore, we are going to lose a lot of the investors in our country. And this is the Western world. The same, of course, also happens elsewhere. Actually, 30 years ago, Ireland was one of the poorest states in the European Union, not comparable to Bulgaria or whatever. It was even much poorer. And by just coming up with an alternative, it's an expensive country because it's an island this far. It's an expensive country. By coming up with a tax rate, which is beneficial, they were able to attract business. And I know there have been mistakes made. I know it all. That's always the case in specific situations. But if you isolate tax competition and you try to challenge that, then you come with a system which will only benefit the bigger states. That's also a situation which I believe has nothing to do with solidarity. So overall, how do I look at G7 and what do I think for the future? Well, the G7 agreement is just an agreement with seven very rich states sitting together and coming to a solution which is not, to my opinion, valid enough. I don't see that there will be a solution before the end of the summer. As being said, I don't see that they will be able to come up with an alternative that suits the requests of the Inclusive Framework members when the Inclusive Framework was created, that any solution on Pillar 1 should be one with mandatory dispute resolution. I see many states like India, which really don't want that. And going for Pillar 2 and not doing Pillar 1 would be a disaster. But still, the US can possibly say, now we will just create a system which is a Pillar 2 system and tax on an innovative CFC kind of a system, whatever, the income from foreign subsidiaries. So a situation where they go on their own. And that's the issue there, is that we have had many inversions to 5-6 years ago in the US, that any other inversion is going to take place. And that's possibly not what you want. And therefore, it's going to be quite difficult to solve this issue in this specific way. Further on, last but not least, I think I have to say that the G7 agreement will now go back to the G20. Then we see states as China. And although I saw some comments that China is not going to lose its position and possibly is going to participate in this initiative, I tend to not believe that, because China also has arrangements in place to attract investment, and possibly is going to be much more important, because you see in the Western world more and more companies going away from China, investing in other states outside China. So China needs also investments in their country. So from my perspective, let me just summarize it a little bit. I am not very satisfied with the G7 agreement. I just think they didn't achieve anything yet. And the smaller countries and the developing countries should be aware of the consequences, because they are going to pay the price, not the bigger countries and the Western wealthy countries. And that's not a situation which I would believe, a situation based on solidarity. I think this is it for now. if Tatsuta wants that, and after the G20 agreement, I would be very willing to comment again on the new proposals. But in the meanwhile, if you have any questions with respect to the G7 agreement, with respect to 12B, because I really believe in that United Nations initiative, or anything else, just let me know. My contact details are available with Tatsuta. Thank you very much.